It was so crazy when Greta was starting to send us storyboards of like Ryan sitting on the bed. It was really exciting, and then it was also like, holy shit, like I hope we're not fucking up their movie if this song doesn't land. Hi, I'm Mark Ronson, and this is The Breakdown. I'm just kidding. Anywhere else I'd be ten. Is it my destiny to live and die a life? This is my studio in New York. I actually had this studio from 2004 to about 2008. And in 2020, I was walking by, and it was actually on Amy Winehouse's birthday. We recorded so much of Amy's stuff here, all the demos for Back to Black. And I hadn't been here in 10 years. I just moved back to New York, and I said, wouldn't it be great to rent this place again? I do believe in energy and juju. So I do think that like coming in here and people like Norah Jones and Amy Winehouse being fairly unknown and making these records that mean so much to people, you know, this, I feel like there's a good energy in this space. And now I've been back here for 3 years. And this is where me and my partner, Andrew, wrote all the songs for Barbie, and we wrote the score. So I read this script and I just was so in love with it. I just thought it was the funniest thing. It was so warm, and beneath all the obvious brilliant comedy, there were these like stories of these two totally misunderstood people like searching for their thing. And I told Greta, I was like, I'd love to do anything on this film. And she said, there are two songs. We need this song for Barbie for this big dance party. And we need a Ken song. And Ken wasn't originally going to sing in the film. They didn't even know what that meant. They just knew that both of their stories were important, so they needed a song for both. I started working on the track that became Dance the Night right away because they were starting dance rehearsals in 2 weeks. They were like, we need something to start choreography. And we didn't know Dua Lipa was going to be on it and write the song yet. And then I started to think about this Ken song. And I was walking to the studio one morning and I just had that line, like, I'm just Ken, anywhere else I'd be a 10. Because obviously I knew Ryan Gosling was playing it. You knew Ken was going to be hot. But there's this idea that he's in the wrong place. He's not in his right time. He's not appreciated. And I just went to the piano with that line. And I was just like looking for chords, like something that was like emotive and moving. So like it balanced maybe the slight humor in the lyric. Because you know, the whole thing about Greta in this movie is like, we're laughing, but we're never laughing at these people. You know, we're there with them on this journey. And I just had that chorus. That's sort of how the song was born. I didn't really have words for this part. I just knew that blonde fragility was like going to be in there somewhere, but I mumbled it as well because Greta and Noah are so clever and so funny in their script, and I didn't want them to think that like I was trying to be funny too. Like they just asked me to write a song, not to provide more humor. So I kind of mumbled that line and I sent it to Greta. They were in England. She sent back these really excited texts. This is amazing. What is this in this chorus? And like, this feels like it's from a movie, and I want to see the movie that this song was from. And then she was like, are you saying something about blonde fragility in there? And I was like, Yeah. I mean, it was just an idea. And she's like, I love it. So that was it. So they were excited about the demo. And then I called Andrew Wyatt, who's one of my closest friends, one of my favorite people to write with, and one of the most talented songwriters and singers I know. And he came up with the verse. Doesn't seem to matter what I do. I'm always number two. No one knows how hard I tried. Yeah, he's doesn't seem to matter what I do. And I was instantly like, oh, that's great. That's our verse. And then we got a little bit of writer's block. We were trying to mess with some next lines. And Noah and Greta had sent us this little one-page sheet that was like very cheekily titled Barbie and Ken Hit Songs. You know, like no pressure, just write us two smashes for Barbie and Ken. And it was like kind of really ridiculous, eccentric things like Barbie, everything is perfect because in Barbie Land there are seven suns, so there are never shadows. Just all these kind of like funny, very Greta Gerwig like ramblings. And then for Ken, it was like, he loves horses, he longs for the touch of Barbie, he has no genitals. And then it was like, he has feelings he can't explain. And we were just kind of like, that one looks good, yeah. So then we were just kind of, then that's how we sort of just went straight to this next part. I have feelings that I can't explain. They're driving me insane. the parts that we started to come up with here. Hang behind the tent and fall for me. Which changed to Fight for Me. Yeah, so there were just, a lot of the parts were there. We just wrote this 2.5 minute song, and that's all it was, without the Kenergy part, without the crazy shred solos from Wolf. And we went to the edit suite where Greta was starting to assemble the movie. And because she had taken a 2.5 minute song but made it this 11 minute sequence, she had just looped parts over and over again of the song. And it was like so hard to listen to and so repetitive and horrible that me and Andrew were just like, we can't let you listen to this like for the next 6 months or till whenever you get your composer to do your score or whatever. Like, do you want to just give us this and we'll just at least write you an 11 minute piece of music? You don't have to use it, but at least while you're editing. So we started to write these other movements, like the thing that became the crazy Wolf guitar solo. And then when it goes back to the Barbies, it goes back to this kind of more like triumphant orchestral part. Me and Andrew were just playing all the instruments. We were using, you know, our orchestral libraries to do all these different string parts, and Greta just really dug it. And so she basically said, okay, cool, this scene is yours. And Greta called to say, I'm gonna shoot this dream ballet sequence. Can you give me one more section of the song? Because it already had like kind of 3 or 4 sections already kind of a little weird. And we're like, yeah, sure. Like, what do you want? Do you want it to be even like more? Because it's already doing a lot. She's like, I need the most maximalist thing you've ever written. She's like, it's this dream ballet and they're gonna have a dance off and I want tempo and pace. So that's when we wrote the music for the Kenergy part, but we hadn't written any words. We sent that to Greta just like as an instrumental passage 2 months later when we saw what it looked like and that amazing thing in Simu and Ryan and all the choreography. We had been playing with the word Kenergy. It was like maybe in another part of the song, but we hadn't put in anything. And as soon as we saw that, we're like, what is this but Kenergy? There is no other word to describe what we're seeing on the screen. So that's when Andrew and I came up with a Can You Feel Kenergy part. And I truly believe that if we hadn't have come up with that word, someone definitely would have come up with it by now. And then when we knew that it was finally done and it was finally in a good place, that's when we started to record the real instrumentation. So that's when we got in the studio with Josh Fries, this incredible drummer, you know, played in Nine Inch Nails and Foo Fighters and just one of the best drummers around. Roger Manning played the synths from Beck's band and tons of records. There's this scene in the film when Ryan like rips open the mink and it's like that big moment where he's about to battle Simu, which has like a whole different movement and some different stuff that's actually not in the soundtrack version, which has these like crazy, crazy guitar solos. This solo was played by Wolfgang Van Halen. The Barbies in pink plotting, you know, the downfall, and they have the binoculars. So that was actually this guitar solo. And because I can't play anywhere near that fast, I actually recorded it when I wrote it in halftime, so it sounded like this. But obviously I can't play it at the regular tempo because it's insane. But then when we asked Wolf to play, he just heard and he was like, oh yeah, I can play that. And give you like all the little juicy bits. And then Slash is playing through the whole song, but really his solo moments are just like the classic like Slash stuff. Friend, woman. Slash was like one of those ideas that just sounded like such a pie in the sky, like dream. Like I remember asking George Trakoulias, the music supervisor, I was like, somebody like Slash. And he's like, why don't you ask Slash? I was like, Slash isn't going to play on this. He's like, you never know, just ask. So I sent him the song. He's like, this is actually really good. Ryan Gosling's a really good singer. He said, it's a cool arrangement. He's like, yeah, I'll play on it. So he sent it and he just did these like his amazing Slash, his tone and his playing. And then the orchestra, we worked on the whole score with our arranger, orchestrator, Matt Dunkley, who's awesome. We had done a lot of the stuff, me and Andrew, he had added some really nice bits. And then at the end, we went into Abbey Road and did the orchestra with the proper whole 60-piece orchestra that was playing on the rest of the score. So, I mean, even just listening to like,
I'm just kidding, anywhere else I'd be beaten. Is it my destiny to live and die a life of blood fragility? I'm just kidding.
Like I could honestly just listen to the strings and Ryan sing because it's such a beautiful performance by the orchestra and the arrangement's really nice. So it's like, yeah, just listening to these little bits. You know, when we came in, we had like 2-3 hours to record the whole song because they were going to shoot it. You know, obviously the point was to record it first so he knew what he was performing to. You know, there's always something awkward and amazing, but like terrifying about the first session you ever do with the singer, because it's like a mixture of like this awkward first blind date, and it's so vulnerable, this place, more vulnerable for the singer, but the producer also, you're like giving your input and your opinions, because the song and the range is just so crazy and all over the place. He was like, should we try it a little lower? And I was like, sure, so we should move it down a key just so it wasn't so crazy. And then as he started to sing, I was like, sounds good. Should we bring it up one? You know, it's like, yeah, I feel good about that. And then maybe I think you sound really great. Should we bring it up one more? And he's like, yeah, cool. And then he just started to sing and he's in the booth. I'm on this side. I'm trying not to look up almost because it's sort of rude to scare. And then someone, when they're singing, it's so in their personal space. But I did occasionally look up and he was like performing the song almost like an opera singer, like on stage, like with his whole body. He was just giving this performance that was just so like from his gut and soul, even though he swears to this day that Ken sung the song and he didn't sing the song. Whoever was in the booth singing the song, it was just so amazing. And then that was the point where I realized like, this is actually gonna be way better than we even thought. Cause we're in there worrying like, will he be able to sing it in this range? We hadn't gambled for the fact that like one of the greatest young actors of his generation was gonna then bring that to the song and actually bring this full performance and everything about Ken that he had been living in for the past 6 months. And then he started to change the nuance and some of the ways that the lines were delivered and made the funny lines funnier and the heartfelt lines more heartfelt and the frustrated lines more frustrated. And I was looking up, I was like, thinking to myself, is he performing this? Almost like the microphone is also a camera, because is he already thinking how he's gonna have to do this? I wasn't sure, that was just like what was going on in my mind, because it was just such a visceral, all-encompassing performance. And it's everything that he does in the film, right? It's comedic, it's heartbreaking, it's funny, it's arrogant, it's all of these, it's just such a masterful performance, and that's what he did on the song.